Hello, my name is Ryan St Laurent. I'm a PhD student here at the Kawahara Lab at the Florida Museum of Natural History. I study an obscure, strange family of moths that is called the sackbearer moths, only found in the neotropical region. They are really weird because their caterpillars make little houses out of poop, silk, and plant material. So the name sackbearer comes from these cases that the larvae construct. They're caterpillars of these moths, which we call scientifically Mimallonidae, make these little houses, which are sometimes termed cases or sacks, but they're made of leaves, silk, and poop, actually, which we call frass in the entomology world. So even though this looks basically just like leaves, underneath the surface is a network of poop and silk, essentially. And it's all brown, so it's kind of hard to distinguish, but there's a different pattern and texture here, and that's because some of the leaf has been removed. And what you see is this brown silk and poop network that is actually forming the structure. If you were to squeeze down on this, it's really hard. And that's because of all that stuff that's underneath the leaves. The sack bearers have a very flat butt. It's really strange. No other caterpillars have such a unique hind end. In this species, it's flat and circular, so that way it perfectly fits into the opening of the case. And on the other side is a similar hole. And this one, it's not plugged right now, but the caterpillar is down inside there. And if it really wanted to, it can jam its head there, because its head is really thick and circular and will block this end. So it has a really good strategy to block either end of this sack. And mainly it just stays inside here all day, and then when it gets hungry, it'll stick out its, you know, the first third of its body and munch on some leaves and then retreat back in when it's done feeding or whenever it feels threatened. And they make these sacks and as a protective measure. They hide within them and they connect them to their host plant, and then they feed. And whenever they need to move, they will detach their sacks and then they'll drag it, much like a hermit crab drags its shell around. If there's a vibration or something, they'll quickly retreat back into these sacks that they bear. So we utilize anchored hybrid enrichment, which is a really cutting edge molecular technique, to understand the phylogeny, which is a tree of life, of an extremely poorly studied moth family that has never had a tree of life developed before. And this is basically a method to capture as many pieces of the genome of whatever you're studying at one time, and then you can consolidate all this information and you can actually determine how closely related or distantly related different organisms are based off of comparisons of the genetic material. Previously, researchers have focused predominantly on ethanol or alcohol-preserved wet frozen specimens. And while these specimens are great because you can get a lot of DNA from frozen specimens, the majority of natural history collections store their specimens dry. In order to try to take advantage of this essentially millions of specimens that are out there, we wanted to see if anchored hybrid enrichment would work for these museum specimens. And in fact, it worked very well. And we were able to get essentially as much DNA from these museum specimens as we would from ethanol-preserved, cold, recently collected material. But now that we know that anchored hybrid enrichment works really well with dry museum specimen, it opens the doors to essentially infinite possibilities of molecular studies, because all around the world there are natural history collections, and every natural history collection has thousands, or in some cases millions, of specimens. And these specimens, whether they were collected 100 years ago or yesterday, they are valuable in terms of being able to extract DNA from them. And they're basically just waiting to be used for molecular research. And now we know we can use them.